Hello, Bee here, and welcome back to Biology. We're learning about biomes today, which are types of ecosystems. How would you describe the biome that these polar bears live in? The first word that comes to mind is probably cold. Polar bears live in a biome known as the tundra, which is definitely very cold. Do you think our little polar bear family would survive if they were moved to a hot desert biome? Probably not. What if we took a palm tree from a tropical biome and moved it to the tundra with the polar bears? How would it fare? Probably not so great. Organisms are adapted to specific biomes, and many would struggle to survive in a biome very different from their natural habitat. We'll look at some of these biomes in detail today. But before we get started, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to understand how climate differs among biomes, describe the types of life found in different biomes, understand threats to biodiversity in different biomes. Before we jump into these different biomes, let's learn about an abiotic factor that has a decisive role in determining which organisms can survive in a biome. Climate. What's the climate like where you live? Does it tend to be hot or cold for most of the year? Maybe you get a really hot summer but really cold winters. What about precipitation? Does it rain a lot or snow? Does the air often feel humid or is it very dry? These are all questions about climate. Climate is the normal or expected patterns of temperature and moisture in a given area. In our biome pyramid, the warmer biomes are at the bottom, which include the rainforest, seasonal forest, scrubland, savanna, and desert. The biomes generally get cooler as we go up through the temperate and subpolar zones until we reach the tundra, where we would find our polar bear family. On the left side of the pyramid, we have wet biomes such as the rainforest and deciduous forest, but the biomes dry out as we move right until we reach the deserts. While biomes are known for the climate patterns we just saw on the pyramid, the climate will not be completely uniform across an entire biome or ecosystem. Microclimates will appear in certain areas that differ significantly from the surrounding region. This can occur because of the topography of the land and nearness to bodies of water. You'll learn more about microclimates and what causes them in the lesson PDF. A biome is a large area of land that shares a similar climate and life forms. There are at least 10 terrestrial or land-based biomes recognized by scientists, and many biomes can be further subdivided into more specific sub-biomes. Let's look at a worldwide map of major biomes. Can you find where you live on the map? Which biome does the map show for your location? In North America, the most common biomes are the deciduous forest, steppe, and desert. South America has these as well, plus a large area of tropical rainforest. Savannas are common in Africa, while taiga and tundra biomes can be found at far north and south latitudes around the world. We'll look at a few of these biomes in more detail today, and you will do some further exploring of different biomes in the lesson PDF. Let's start with the most diverse biome of all, the tropical rainforest. This biome exists in regions near the equator of Earth, where it stays warm all year, and there is abundant rainfall. These two climate factors make it relatively easy for life to flourish, so we see a wide variety of plants, animals, and other life forms here. The vegetation of tropical rainforests includes tall trees that form a dense canopy layer, as well as an understory of shorter trees, shrubs, and vines above the forest floor. These forests are home to a wide range of plant species, including epiphytes, which are plants that grow on other plants without harming them. This is a form of commensalism that we will discuss more in an upcoming lesson. You'll also find lianas here, which are woody vines that climb up trees. Tropical rainforests are home to a diverse range of animal species, including primates, big cats, reptiles, and a wide range of birds and insects. Many of these species are endemic, meaning they are found nowhere else in the world. Despite their rich biodiversity, tropical rainforests are under threat from deforestation, which is caused by logging, agricultural expansion, and mining. Efforts to protect and conserve tropical rainforests are essential to maintain the health of our planet's ecosystems and biodiversity. Another common and important biome on Earth is the deciduous forest. How does its climate compare to the tropical rainforest on our biome pyramid? They are both wet climates, but deciduous forests are listed as temperate, not tropical. So while deciduous forests receive a significant amount of rainfall, they are not as warm year-round as tropical forests. These forests are found around the world at mid-latitudes and are dominated by deciduous trees, which lose their leaves in winter. The dead leaves that pile up on the ground decompose and provide nutrients for new growth, creating a healthy cycle for the ecosystem. There are four very distinct seasons in a deciduous forest, and a wide variety of animal species, such as deer, foxes, raccoons, bears, woodpeckers, owls, insects, and butterflies. Deforestation can be a problem here too, so conservation efforts focus on sustainable forestry practices, such as selective cutting and replanting. We'll learn more about the responsible use of resources in our sustainability lesson later in this unit. Let's look at one more terrestrial biome. This one will feel very different from the two forest biomes we've seen so far. Deserts. On our biome pyramid, the desert is all the way to the right, so deserts receive very little moisture in the form of precipitation or humidity. Notice that deserts can either be tropical, meaning hot, or temperate, meaning warm or moderate temperatures. This is a hard, unforgiving landscape where water is scarce and temperatures can fluctuate dramatically between day and night. At first glance, deserts can seem dry, desolate, and devoid of any natural life forms, just sand and rock. But there are a few life forms that manage to thrive in this biome, like many different species of cacti, which are drought-tolerant plants capable of surviving on very little water. Some animals are found here too: camels, snakes, lizards, and a few small mammals. But the sparse vegetation makes it difficult for the biome to support a large diversity of animal life. So there are not enough producers to form the bottom of a large energy pyramid here. With little shade in the desert, temperatures often reach over 100 degrees Fahrenheit during the day. But as night falls, there isn't enough humidity in the air to hold in heat, so the temperature quickly drops to near or below freezing. You'll definitely need to dress in layers. Did you know that most deserts didn't used to be deserts? The process of desertification occurs as fertile land dries out and turns into desert biomes. This can be caused by natural or human factors such as rising temperatures, droughts, erosion, overgrazing, and deforestation. Aquatic ecosystems are grouped into freshwater and marine biomes. Freshwater biomes include lakes, rivers, streams, and any bodies of water that are not saltwater. Marine biomes include all the parts of the world's oceans. Freshwater biomes are grouped based on how quickly the water moves. It might seem like a random characteristic, but it turns out that water flow in a freshwater biome is very important for productivity. By productivity, we mean photosynthesis. Highly productive biomes produce a lot of oxygen. What kind of water movement do you think leads to the highest productivity? It turns out that the sweet spot is right in the middle, not too fast and not too slow. These are known as lentic biomes and include lakes and ponds. They tend to have a high diversity of both plants and animals, such as water lilies, cattails, algae, fish, birds, amphibians, insects, and crustaceans. Lotic biomes have fast-moving water, such as rivers and streams. These still support some life, mainly fish, but with nutrients constantly on the move and being washed away, it is more difficult for plant life to thrive in the water. On the opposite extreme, we have wetlands with very still or stagnant water. Biomes such as marshes, swamps, and bogs make productivity difficult because the waterlogged soil leads to less available oxygen. You will find plant species such as duckweed and mangroves here, and animals such as alligators, crocodiles, and many bird species. The other aquatic ecosystems are marine and encompass the oceans. Some major biomes here are the deep ocean, open ocean, and coral reefs. The deep ocean is the largest biome on Earth, covering 60% of the surface. But it's a cold, dark world with no photosynthesis. The organisms found here look rather bizarre. Giant squid, anglerfish, and bioluminescent creatures make up this biome. In the open ocean, above a depth of 1,000 meters, we find much more diversity of life. This is because sunlight can penetrate these shallow waters and allow for photosynthesis. Not only does this result in the production of about half of the world's oxygen, but it provides a solid base for the food webs that exist here, making a high variety of animal life possible. This is also known as the pelagic zone, the word pelagic coming from an ancient Greek word for open sea. In this biome, we find whales, fish, many types of invertebrates, and phytoplankton, the microscopic organisms that are responsible for the ocean's photosynthesis. The last biome we'll look at today is one of the most fun to explore, coral reefs. These marine habitats are found close to shore in warm, tropical waters. The foundation of coral reefs comes from the coral polyps, invertebrate animals who secrete a hard exoskeleton known as coral. The coral polyps have a symbiotic relationship with a species of algae called zooxanthellae, and depend on this algal species to survive. Unfortunately, rising temperatures put coral polyps at risk of extinction due to the phenomenon of coral bleaching, in which the algae die due to high temperatures. Coral reefs are vital parts of the biosphere, as they are home to a vast array of animals, including fish, sea turtles, crabs, rays, and sea stars. As we went through the lesson today, we saw examples of terrestrial and aquatic biomes. Remember that the main difference between different biomes is the climate, which includes the average temperature and moisture available to living things. All biomes are important to the biosphere, as the Earth is one large system with many interconnected parts. Protecting these biomes so that they can sustain a high level of biodiversity will be critical not only to their future, but to ours. Next time, we'll look at succession, which is the changes that ecosystems go through over time. Until then, remember that biology isn't just science. It's the way of life. Hey.